There's a Swahili word for Western Hemisphere people like you and me. The word is Manungu. I'm told it literally means people who spin around. Let's face it, up until just a few weeks ago, that's probably how we would have explained or defined our own lifestyles. Constantly moving one place or another, spinning around, going places in a hurry, maybe constantly even being late. It's how people in other countries see us. Well, today is Palm Sunday. It's a whirlwind of a week, really, when you think about it. This is the only week in the Christian year when we actually slow things down to a 24/7 time frame and see the events and see Jesus walking and teaching in real time. On this day, in this Holy Week, on just this first day, the story says that Jesus paraded into the city of Jerusalem like a hero. People were cutting down palm branches from trees and waving them in the air. And by the way, they're still symbols of Palestinian nationalism. But they were yelling things like, "Hail King Jesus! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna!" Well, that sure got the attention of the Roman authorities, the conquering Roman armies who were watching. But that's not all. In the shadows of the streets that day were Jewish religious leaders as well. They were carefully watching Jesus. Even when the parade ended at the temple and Jesus walked in and created another stir, for when he got into the temple, he turned over the tables of money changers. He chased sheep out of the gates of the temple, shouting things like, "You've made this place a den of thieves, and it's supposed to be a place of prayer." It was just the first day. What a week it was. You know, things can happen quickly sometimes, but it's amazing when you think of the Jesus story. For 3 years, he went about preaching and teaching in large crowds, in open spaces, and he was quite safe. But on this one day, in this one place, he hit them, well, follow the money, right? He hit them in their wallet, and Jesus was dead in a week. What a week it was. But you know, it's not the end of the story. In fact, it's just the prelude to one spectacular, singular event that would change everything. Welcome to worship at Yorkshire Church on this Holy Week, on this Palm Passion Sunday. We're glad you've tuned in. I invite you now to join the parade. Listen to the story as Matthew tells it. That the disciples of Jesus approached the city of Jerusalem, coming from the town of Bethphage of Mount of Olives. Jesus there sent two of them ahead and said, "Go to the village, and you'll see a donkey there with a colt beside it. Untie them and bring them to me. Now, if anyone asks you what you're doing, just say, 'The Lord has need of them,' and he'll immediately send them." This was done to fulfill the prophecy that the king would come, humble and riding on a donkey. The two disciples did as Jesus asked. They brought the animals to him and they threw their garments over the colt, and Jesus sat on it. Most of the crowd spread their coats on the road ahead of Jesus. Others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and all the crowds were around him, shouting, "Praise God, the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in the highest heaven." The entire city of Jerusalem was stirred as Jesus entered the city. "Who is this?" they cried. And the crowd's answer was, "This is Jesus, the prophet of Galilee." Let's pray. Eternal and almighty God, you are the source of our hope. And today we joyfully proclaim Jesus to be the Lord and leader, the Messiah, the King of our lives. We praise you and bless you, the ever-living God, for the acts of love by which you redeemed the world through Jesus. On this day, we remember that he entered the holy city of Jerusalem and was proclaimed by king, by those who spread their garments and palm branches along his way. Let these branches before us be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who wave them, who show them, display them, may always proclaim with our lives that Jesus is the Lord by walking in his way. His way of suffering in the cross, that dying and rising with him, we may enter into your kingdom. This we pray through Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen and amen. Let's welcome the King.
it seems fitting that this is Holy Week. You know, later this week, we'll be having a time to lament and grieve. Grieve for our sins, grieve for the sacrifice that Jesus made. And then after that, there'll be a time of rejoicing. And during this week, I'm sure there will be some of both for all of us. But today we shout Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. When Jesus entered into Jerusalem that day, people shouted and were making a big fuss. There was a big crowd gathered and they were loud and in the way. And so some of the officials told him to make it stop. They said, "Jesus, tell your followers to get out of here. Tell them to be quiet. Tell them to stop creating such a ruckus." And he said, "Even if I told them that, the rocks would cry out for me, because all of creation is going to praise him. Are you? In this time, are you going to praise him? Because if you don't, the rocks will." When he entered into Jerusalem, he was entering into Roman-occupied Jerusalem. He wasn't entering into a pleasant situation. The Jews in Roman-occupied Jerusalem were second-class citizens. They were taken advantage of and beaten for very little reason. But still, those same people praised him when he entered the city. I've been hearing a lot of people recently quote Philippians 4:13. "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." And I think that's a really fitting verse for today. It doesn't mean that I can accomplish great feats or unthinkable tasks because of Christ who strengthens me. Though those things are possible through the power of Christ, that's not what it's referring to. When Paul says that, earlier in the chapter in Philippians 4, he says, "I've been poor and I've been rich. I've been powerful and I've been in prison. I've been all of these things, and I know that I can do all of these things through Christ who strengthens me." And I kind of imagine that that's what Jesus was thinking as he entered into the city that day. I can be praised, or I can be tortured. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. You can live a normal life as we're used to, or you can live this life of social distancing. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. In fact, right now, I want you to turn to whoever it is that you're watching this with. Maybe it's your family or your spouse or your roommate or your dog, or maybe you're just watching it by yourself, but I want you to turn to that person and say, "You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you." Good. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. You are blessed. You come in the name of the Lord to your friends, to your neighbors, to your family. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
The
The whole city of Jerusalem was asking, who is this person who comes? He's Jesus. And the importance of knowing Jesus can never be underscored enough. This is what Paul writes in the scriptures. Whatever happens, may the Lord give you joy. We put no confidence in human effort. Instead, we boast about what Jesus has done. Oh, I could have had confidence in myself if anyone could, Paul writes. If others have reason for confidence, I have more. I mean, I was circumcised when I was 8 days old, having been born into a pure-blooded Jewish family, a branch of the tribe of Benjamin. I am a real Jew if there ever was one. And what's more, I was once a Pharisee. I was never accused of any fault. I once thought these things were so very important, but Paul says I now consider them worthless because of what Jesus has done. Yes, everything else, he says, is worthless when compared with the priceless gain of knowing Jesus as Lord. I've discarded everything else. I counted it all as garbage that I may have Jesus and be one with him. Now, I don't mean to say that I've already achieved these things, that I have already reached perfection, but I keep working toward the day when I'll finally be all that Jesus saved me to be and wants me to be. I'm focusing all my energies on this one thing, forgetting the past and looking forward to what lies ahead. I am straining to reach the end of the race and to receive the prize for which God, through Christ Jesus, is calling us. This is the word of God for the people of God. Let's pray. Breathe on me, breath of God, until I'm wholly yours. And let the words of my mouth and the things that we think about in our hearts and minds be acceptable in your sight. For Lord, you are our strength and our Redeemer, and in you we trust. Amen. One of the toughest things that I learned about being the grandfather of young children is having to play games at their level. Games that really are a little bit outside of my interests, if you will. I'd rather play some roughhouse games with balls that you kick and hit and catch, but playing games with young kids demands another kind of game. One of those games was a game called Memory, and I remember our youngest grandson, even at 4 years old, he would just wipe me up and talk smack as he was doing it, cleaning my clock, if you will, playing the game of memory. I got to tell you, I still hate the game of memory. But speaking of memory, how's yours? You know, one of the common things that I think we all experience is that we can remember sometimes in vivid detail things that happened a long time ago. And then there's other times when we can't remember why we walked into a room. Now, experts say there's reasons and explanations for that. It has to do with neurology and developmental theories, things I sure don't understand. But here's the thing I wonder. Why is it so easy for us to remember things we ought to forget, and so tough to forget things we need to remember? By definition, the verb to remember is to recall something that was forgotten or to keep something in your memory. Literally, to remember is to put things that were broken back together, to remember them. That's exactly why we gather together to worship on a weekly basis. So that in our busy manungu, kind of spinning around, constantly running from here to here lives, we can pause for just a moment to remember who God is and whose we are. We can remember that we are loved by God. We can remember that there's nothing that can ever separate us from the love of God that's ours through faith in Jesus Christ our Lord. We can remember that we have been blessed by God in order to be a blessing and a source of blessing to others so that the world itself might be blessed. In many ways, this is the purpose of this Holy Week, to slow us down and to slow the story of God's grace in our actual time, so that we might remember the command of Jesus to love one another as he loved us, to remember that Jesus made it possible for us to have life and to have it abundantly because of what he did for us on the cross long ago. It's quite a story that we tell in this Holy Week. It's quite a story that we remember. It's not about ordinary times, but about the privilege that we have to walk close with Jesus, all because of what he's done for us. Remember and never forget, the scriptures say, what's behind you, so that you can strain forward to what lies ahead, pressing on in faith to what Jesus has set before us as a goal. It sounds so easy to do, remembering what Jesus has done so that we might live. Again, the question, why is it so easy for us to remember things from the past that we ought to forget? Why is it so easy for us to keep holding on to those things that have been forgiven in our past? Why do we keep reliving that past, imagining sometimes that God can't forgive me, that God can't remember us, put us back together? When you're thinking about those things, I want you to know that that's really the tempter, that's really the devil who's speaking to you, pulling you away from Jesus. Because here's the deal. If you have asked God to forgive you, by faith in Jesus, if you've received that gift of grace and forgiveness because of what he did for you in that Holy Week long ago, you're not a hostage to your sins anymore. You're not a captive to those old wounds and old grudges and old addictions and old fears. You are not stuck in your past. You are a new person in Jesus Christ. You've been remembered. So move on. Why? Because there is ministry and mission. There is work for us to do in the world today in the name of Jesus, loving God and loving others, serving God and serving others. But on the other hand, if you've never named your sin, if you've never confessed your sin, if you've never told God that you're sorry, that you know that he knows, that you know that he knows you made a mess of your life, today can be your day to be forgiven. Today can be the day Jesus remembers you. You can do this right now from wherever you are. You can be forgiven and remembered by doing something like praying a simple prayer like this. Jesus, I've been living my way for far too long. I've drifted far from where I ever wanted to be in my life. I'm sorry. Forgive me. I'm not in a good place, but I know you love me. So take my sin and my guilt and my shame away and help me to put my faith and my life totally in your hands. Remember me and help me never to forget your amazing grace. For I am yours now, completely and forever, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've prayed a prayer or something like that right now, welcome home. Welcome home. Remember and never forget this moment, for you are no longer broken. You are no longer living in dismembered pieces. God has remembered you and put you back together. God has made you whole and well, and that's what salvation really is. And our desire as followers of Jesus is always to come closer to Christ. So whether you're a brand new Christian, whether you've been a follower of Jesus for a long time, let me close by giving you a very practical takeaway, something you can do to help you today and all the days to follow remember who you are and whose you are. Here's something you can do every day to help you remember God's forgiving grace and His love for you and never forget it. Here's something that you can do so that you never go back and dredge up that old sin, that checkered past, that guilt and worry. It's an old Christian practice of daily praying what's called a prayer of examine. Here's what you do. You set aside some time every day to have a little talk with Jesus. And that's what prayer is. Make it a habit. This prayer of examine is better prayed at the end of the day, but you can pray it at any time during the day. Because what you do is ask and answer two very simple questions. Remember, this prayer time is a conversation with God, who knows everything about you. He knows the answers to these questions, so don't play games. Be honest. The first question to ask and answer is, where and when today did I feel lost, alone, far from Jesus? And then the second question is like it. Where and when today did I feel close to Jesus, alive and empowered, hopeful, and aware of His presence in my life? I want to encourage you to perhaps keep a prayer journal if you've never done so. To keep a journal of your answers to those two questions. To start learning in your own life experience what it is that you're doing and what's happening when you're feeling far from Jesus, and what you're doing and what's happening when you feel close to Him. Praying this prayer of examine is a means by which Christians for centuries have come closer to Christ. It's a practice that you can use to help you discover Jesus in your life and your life lived in His. Try it. Practice it. And eventually, you might even remember why you walked into the room. Let's pray. You know all about us, and we are still yours. You loved us so much that you came risking your life for ours. You rode into dangerous places to rescue people like us, to redeem, to remember us. And you did it all for a purpose, so that we might come closer to you, but not stop there. But being close to you, being empowered by your Holy Spirit, we might go our own ways into the places you send us, and to there share the grace and the mercy, the love of Jesus to all whom we meet. Lord, we live in difficult days right now. Dismembered in many ways from the life we once knew. Remember us today, that we might know you and follow you in whatever that new life might be when, again, we are able to engage in work, in play, in school, in life. Others who are feeling dismembered and need your love in their life too. Lord, hear our prayers today. The prayers we offer in silence, the prayers we offer aloud. Take them and use us, we pray, in Jesus' great name. Amen. Holy Week, the shadows of the cross begin to gather more and more. On the road to Jerusalem, we're walking with Jesus right now. May you have a blessed Holy Week as we continue to worship Him, Jesus, our Lord.
Jesus. People come to call his name, Son of David, heal us. Down the ancient streets he rides, a donkey is his stallion. No golden coach, no chariot bright, brings him to his kingdom. Where is his chariot? Where is his robe of silk? Where is his scepter? Where is his crown? Where are the trumpets? How will he rule the land if he comes as a prince of peace?
To Jerusalem rides the man of sorrows. Save us, King, the people cry. What will they cry tomorrow?